Well, good evening, everyone, and thank you all for joining us for this special SOAS Centenary lecture. I am Professor Mashoud Badarin, Professor of Law at SOAS here. I'm Chair of the Center of African Studies here at SOAS. It is an absolute honor for me to be welcoming the Nobel Prize winning poet and playwright Professor Wole Soyinka to SOAS for our special centenary lecture, which also doubles as the 2016 Center of African Studies annual lecture. I mean, personally, I've always been intrigued by Professor Soyinka's literary works, some of which I read as an undergraduate law student in Nigeria to improve my use of English, I mean, in the local context. I remember reading his Death of the King's Horseman, which I understood and enjoyed very much. But his Mad Men and Specialists, I struggled to understand them, but still enjoyed or pretended to enjoy all the same. As a pioneer Nigerian academic who has inspired many Nigerian academics of my generation, I would like to use this rare opportunity to pay homage to him in his native Yoruba language. We say, Mujuba Dasa. Professor Soyinka was awarded an honorary fellowship by SOAS in 2002 for his contributions as an internationally renowned writer and a political and human rights activist. He has received several accolades, including the Nobel Prize for Literature in 1986, the first writer of African descent to be so honored. His life began as a scholar at University of Ibadan and continued at the University of Leeds. In 1960, thanks to a Rockefeller bursary, he returned to Nigeria to study traditional African drama. He later taught at the universities of Ibadan, Lagos, and Ife as lecturer and senior lecturer during a turbulent time for Nigeria, which culminated in civil war. For his opposition to the war, he was held a political prisoner for 26 months, 22 of which he spent in solitary confinement. Following his release in 1969, he took up position as head of Department of Theatre Arts at the University of Ibadan. He became professor of comparative literature at the University of Ife in 1975. He has also held academic posts at Yale, Cambridge, and Harvard, amongst others. Tonight, I'm pleased to say Professor Soyinka will be in conversation with our SOAS director, Baroness Valerie Amos. Baroness Amos, as some of you may know, joined as director of SOAS in September 2015. From 2010, she served as Undersecretary General for Humanitarian Affairs and Emergency Relief Coordinator at the United Nations. She has also served in a number of roles in the public sector, including in local government and as Chief Executive of the Equal Opportunities Commission. Valerie was an advisor to the Mandela government on leadership, change, management, and strategy issues between 1994 and 1998. In June 2016, she was made a companion of honor in the Queen's Birthday Honors List. Before I say a little bit on tonight's conversation, I would like to, call and introduce our guest, Professor Wole Soyinka, and our director, Baroness Valerie Amos. Thank you. Tonight's conversation promises to offer us insights ranging from the impact and legacy of Wole's winning the 1986 Nobel Prize for Literature, Nigerian politics, art, and political change, and thoughts on returning to Britain and the state of the nation today. I can safely say this promises to be a stimulating and thought-provoking discussion. As this evening's event is in celebration of SOAS's 100 years, I'd like to say a few words about our history. Some of you may have seen, coming in today, the fascinating centenary exhibition titled Academics, Agents, and Activists, A History of SOAS, 1916 to 2016, currently in SOAS's Brunei Gallery. If you haven't visited, I encourage you to do so. The exhibition presents the history of SOAS from a human perspective and highlights SOAS's wider impact on world history, scholarship, cultural preservation, politics, social development, and the arts. Indeed, this special series of lectures, of which we are all part this evening, is also in recognition of our extraordinary 100-year history. Next month, we shall also be hosting artist and social activist Forrest Whitaker, and also the Nobel Peace Prize winner Mohamed El Baradei, and the food writer and author Claudia Roden as part of the series. In my mind, this demonstrates what an important space SOAS provides for debate, discussion, and asking the questions that matter. And this is why for our centenary year, we have launched the Questions Worth Asking, so that our students and academics can keep on asking and also answering today's most important questions. We ask, is there a solution to the world's refugee crisis? What happens after war? Should we all speak the same language? What makes a global citizen? And will there ever be equality? It is true to say that for 100 years, we have been asking certain questions, and through this campaign, we hope to seek support for scholarships and student experience initiatives, academic projects and endowed posts, and also transforming the SOAS Institute. You can learn more about this campaign on our website, soas.ac.uk/questions. I will encourage you all to take a look. Finally, before I take my exit, I will ask that you please check your phones and see that they are on silent. And if you are tweeting, which we very much hope that you will do, please use hashtag SOAS100, hashtag SOAS100. Thank you, and I shall now pass you over to Valerie Amos, Valerie Amos and Wole Soyinka. I hope you all enjoy this evening's discussion. Thank you very much.
Masood, thank you so much indeed for that introduction. And Professor Soyinka, welcome again to SOAS. It's a huge pleasure to have you with us. When I said to my nieces and nephews that I was having this conversation with you, they said, but he's a legend. So welcome to a legend to SOAS. Thank you so much for joining us this evening. We have, up until 8 o'clock for our conversation, plus some questions from our audience. It's not a huge amount of time, given the extraordinary life you've had and continue to have. And I wanted to ask, by way of a question to start, over 60 years ago, you became a student in Britain. What stands out from that experience, both in terms of your experience in the classroom, but also outside? What was Britain like then?
Well, I was largely in the countryside, as you remember, and one underwent different kind of sensations, experiences, encounters in a university atmosphere. Very different from, let's say, when I stepped into London, where again it was almost like being in a different country. In fact, it took a while for me to get used to the language which is spoken in Yorkshire, and they claimed it is English. But one thing which stood out was the unexpected. Oh, I knew about it. We used to call it color discrimination. Racism wasn't really a very current word at the time. It was mostly color discrimination. And that was uniform, both ways. both sides have their own individual ways of expressing it, but it was very strong. And in London, however, there was, of course, a sort of cosmopolitan darling of that experience. In Yorkshire, I think they were just the outside of the Yorkshire people, there were just the Africans and the Indians. I think the Indians were the only racial group that was particularly remarkable. What was that? That's what struck me most nasty, you know, apart from the dirt. The dirt, I didn't know that even buildings could be dirty. And they were sooty, and the air was constant smog, even in summer, and I didn't know how people lived in that environment.
And how did you survive it?
How did I survive it? Well, first of all, when I experienced the first winter, I made up my mind that I had been sent to the United Kingdom to be killed. No, firstly, one of those unsolved perfect crimes. You know, just walking along the street and falling down dead. In the room, perhaps, falling down dead. So one thing which I did, which I mentioned in my memoirs, was that I said, well, there seem to be human beings in this place, and some of them actually appear to grow to a ripe old age. I said, that has to be due to something they eat and drink. So I ate every single disgusting bit of English cuisine to the last for one solid year. I had the breakfast, which wasn't too bad. The lunch, the so-called high tea, the gravy, the soggy vegetable. It was a discipline which I've never matched in anything in the world. At the end of 1 year, I said, now I'm immunized. I dropped it, and I never went back to English food again. Anything but, even if it's just bread and butter, which is universal. I just stopped eating English food. I think that's why I survived.
Well, now, 60 years on, you have traveled a huge amount. Even in the last couple of weeks, you've been in the United States, you've been in Azerbaijan, you've been in Italy. What's different about Britain now? And what do you see that's better and what is worse?
Oh, the Britain of that time was certainly not the Britain of today. First of all, Britain has become more international, more cosmopolitan. I think maybe when I was a student, there was perhaps one single espresso machine, coffee machine, here at the time. Pasta.
Even in the whole of Britain?
In all of England. Well, obviously there would have been plenty. But let's say I was here during the Italian Revolution here. And of course, the Indians were always here, and this is where we mostly went to eat. And usually just very, very unadventurous. And I remember when the first tandoori shop was opened in Soho. You know, and I was quite correct that the British people, they were suffering. They were really the masochists. Because the line which went, in Soho, I can still show you the shop, where the first tandoori shop was opened. And these people who thought all of Indian cuisine was sweet and sour and curry, chicken curry. They were queuing all around the square into the streets around about and so on. They'd never tasted anything so good in their lives. And that's when I was quite correct, you know, about my assessment. But generally, the attitude is different. There's a greater universalism, which has been progressing all the time. If you check out the period of Margaret Thatcher, of course, when there was a kind of regression, like we're about, I think, to witness these days. But this is not a Britain of my youth in England, no.
One of the things that worries us enormously as a university is that, and a because we're very open. Our entire history is about the study of our regions, about looking at the world through the lens of our regions, having a global perspective. And we're concerned about the impact of the referendum vote, the vote to leave the European Union, but also that Britain, the openness that we've seen in Britain in the past is closing down. Do you have a view about that and about what is happening, for example, in the United States, what's happening in other parts of Europe in terms of the, what they're saying about refugees and closing borders? Is this something that you think our world is going to have to live with, or is this something that is short-lived that we're going to be able to overcome?
I think what's happening in Britain today, what seems to be the will of the majority, is not peculiar to Britain. There's a kind of ultra-nationalism, you know, rampaging around the whole globe, whether we're talking about Britain or France or Italy, I think to some extent, even the Scandinavian countries are getting a whiff of that ill wind. It has to do, I think, with the expanding village. And some people, some temperaments, some collective temperaments, if you like, some national characteristics, well, an expression I don't like very much, but something is evident. There's a kind of fear of being overwhelmed, a kind of cultural fear, loss of identity, sort of saying to the rest of the world, all right, you're talking about your identity, we're talking about ours. There's also the economic factor. The economy of the world has been fluctuating wildly over the decade or two, and so there's fear of loss of jobs, of standard of living. And these are, for me, just instances of, I like sometimes use the expression, the chicken is coming home to roost. European countries forget very often that they expanded, and they expanded against the will of many countries all over the world, which we call colonies today. The instinct towards expansion, I think it's a very human one. And if these nations look into their own history, they'll find that they also took up space outside. And so, if things now turn difficult in other areas, they must expect a return journey. It seems to me a law of nature. Then, of course, there is the balance side of that ultra-nationalism leading to sheer brutal acts of racism, whether you're talking about the Turks in Germany, or you're talking about the African-Americans, or Afro-Brits in Britain. Then there's the rise of religious fundamentalism, with its backlash, again, an inevitable consequence of excess, of intolerance on one side, which is then coalesces into drawing inwards and saying, ours is ours, let us protect ours. But then the world itself has changed, and I think the progressive outlook is to recognize that and to stay on the side of openness, because it's inevitable. There's movement, and that movement is not about to stop.
Well, in your own country, in Nigeria, of course, you've been an outspoken critic of any number of governments. You have been jailed for your beliefs. Last year, there was an article, an interview with you in The Guardian, where you were extremely critical of the election and the electoral process. And it's been almost a labor of love for you to really watch the development of your country and to contribute to it in a positive way and to be critical of abuses as you see them. Are you getting tired of that labor of love?
Oh, that's a good question. There's certainly a side of serious resentment in me. It's no question at all, because I know what I would rather be doing at any given moment, during any given period. I know what my companies, and I know and I crave for certainly more leisure than I have. Even hobbies for me, I was in Australia. But don't laugh now. But I think all of this is largely because I am a basically lazy person. Really, I said don't laugh. I knew there was some cynicism, but basically, I would rather not be doing many of the things I'm doing. I would rather just be on my own, closed circle, theater, creativity of some sort, organizing a festival here, holding a workshop here, giving some abstruse lectures on Yoruba cosmology somewhere. It's what I'd rather be doing. But then, when you step out, your house and you see of your office, lecture room, and you see children rooting in a garbage heap, you just feel, I want to get back as quickly as possible to what I would rather be doing, so let me quickly take care of that problem. So that's what I mean about the paradox of my existence. When you see politicians, even civil servants, exercising their little corner of power to the detriment of human comfort and rights. Rights have been trampled upon right, left, and center. You travel from my hometown to what is supposed to be a commercial capital, and a journey that should take about 1 hour takes 3, 4, at the end of which your spine has to be reassembled, you know, somewhere or the other, then you just feel you cannot concentrate on what you'd rather be doing, so you move to take care of that problem. You have a brutal military regime, you know, stopping with soldiers, ordinary soldiers stopping people in the streets and trying to whip them into submission. And then the civilian government does its best to outdo even military brutality. Then it becomes a non-stop, taking care of exterior business when you'd rather be taking care of the interior. So that's why I say I'm driven purely, mostly by laziness. I want to get back to being lazy.
Well, I'm going to press you a little bit on this, because given the commitment you've shown and the personal sacrifices, and given the importance of Nigeria to the world, to the African continent and to the world, what continues to inspire you about your country? Because it's not just the laziness, as you describe it, and wanting to get through these social issues quickly so that you can get into other things. There must be other things that inspire you about Nigeria and keep you going. What are those?
There's something about that multicultural and multinational space called Nigeria. It's so rich that, that's the other thing, that maybe I'm greedy. I don't want to be deprived of what I was born into. I appreciate, when I was in exile first, I was in exile twice, and I always had to pretend to myself that I was not in exile. I used to use expressions like, oh, I'm just on a political sabbatical. And I would go with them. And I know that I carried Nigeria with me everywhere, not just my own Yoruba, immediate Yoruba space. I traveled the length and breadth of Nigeria. I don't think there's any corner that I don't know. And that was, my father was not an itinerant teacher, my mother was not an itinerant trader. I was curious about the space into which I was born. Got into it. I remember a Volkswagen with a friend. I would go to the east one day, go to the left another one. And then I was doing research in dramatic form also, so that enabled me to travel even over and beyond what my actual research required, which is why I never wrote it up. You're so busy absorbing the place. And so I miss it when I'm not there, quite frankly. I miss it. As as you see from even distorted films, an outsider can see, can actually feel the vitality of that mission, the potential, the warmth and generosity of the people themselves when they are left alone, when they are not being persecuted. And there are some white Nigerians here. They think they've left Nigeria, but Nigeria has never left them. They admit it, that they cannot take Nigeria out of their system. How much more somebody who is born and raised and who loves nature?
I'm sure we'll come back to some of this when I turn over to questions from the audience on the political side. But if I may, I'd like to turn a bit to your writing and the role that that writing has played in your life. Can you say a little bit about its central importance to who you are and what you're about?
The central importance of
your writing.
My writing. Mm-hmm. I don't know that. You see, I become used to it, and if I were deprived of it, I think I would become schizophrenic. I know, for instance, when I was in prison detention, it was as if my jailers knew this. They sort of made sure they deprived me of my typewriter, paper, pen, and so on and so forth. And I made do so. From that experience alone, I can say quite honestly that writing has become a part of me. And I began very early. I was, this is attested by both my parents and my early teachers. I was a really precocious reader at a very early age. I read everything, including magazine advertisements. I read them as if they were literature. And so sooner or later, I suppose it was inevitable I would also try my hand at something that, for one reason or the other, gave me such pleasure and such meaning, such sense of fulfillment. So it's a critical aspect.
And what impact did winning the Nobel Prize have on you personally? You were the first African to win it, to win the Nobel Prize for Literature. Did you feel that there were then expectations of you that you wanted to meet or could not meet? I mean, what impact did it have, and what impact has it had subsequently?
Unforgivable crime against humanity, which I experienced, was that very word, expectation. But it wasn't literary expectation. It wasn't expectations in the discipline for which I got the award. No, it was expectation for everything, even just to show my face. Now, that kind of expectation is pretty brutal. And you had to now, and for some time, I thought it was natural. I thought it was a fair price to pay for the prize. After a while, of course, it got past, exhausting, and I became resentful. But that didn't stop me answering the call somewhere or the other, because then it became a question, oh, yes, 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 we know you went there. Why aren't you coming here? I said, there's only one of me, to the best of my knowledge, you know, in the African world and Europe, so give me a break, as people say. And I was summited by saying that I came to understand perfectly how right Bernard Shaw was when he won the prize. And he said that he could forgive the devil who invented dynamite. That it took a special, wicked, diabolical mind to create the Nobel Prize for Literature. I could understand that.
Well, let's pause for a moment and take some questions from our audience. Who'd like to ask a question? Yep, we've got one down here. Can we use this one then? Thank you. you'll say who you are.
My name is Chibundu. Thank you very much for your talk. I'm a PhD student. I'm researching the West African Students Union. And you wrote the West African Students Union. And you wrote about it in one of your memoirs. And I just wondered if you could...
Could you speak up a little bit? I have a problem.
Okay. I'm a PhD student. And I'm researching the West African Students Union. And you wrote about it in one of your memoirs. And I just wondered if you had any kind of further reflections on the group.
What did I write about African students?
The West African Students Union.
Uh-huh.
Yes.
West African Union. Yeah, that's where we used to plot the liberation of Africa.
Do you feel you succeeded?
Yes,
do you feel you succeeded?
No. But it was very nice dreaming, you know.
any more reflections on the students?
Recollection. Nigerians have a history, you know, of envisioning at some level or the other. As I was speaking, I suddenly remember that same West African Students Union was home to. Perhaps one of the very first, one of the very few Africans who actually wanted to join the, what's the name of that free army for against fascism in Spain? He actually wanted to sign up to go to Spain to fight the International Brigade, which was formed in the United States. I don't know many other people Africans who wanted to do that. In fact, one of them actually traveled to Spain, a prince, naturally of Abuja, you know, where I come from, you know, and tried to join the brigade. There was something very, this is where the first Pan-Africanists, even non-Africans, the ones who used to come from the United States, for instance, they would go to the West African Students Union. Paul Robeson was a frequenter of that place. I'm not sure if Martin Garvey actually made it in his time, but you had some of the early intellectuals of the Pan-Africanist movement. They would always stop at WASU, which was called West African Students Union. And I met, of course, many African students from various parts, not just black students, not just from the continent, but from the diaspora, which was why it was a kind of a wonder to me when certain West African students, when the riots began in Notting Hill, etc., the great riots, in a pile with his triforce turned to violent use, and these sort of clashes began. You actually had some students, an editor of recollection, who wrote in the journal that West African students were not the problem, but the labor, the laboring class from the West Indies, because you know they came on a boat at one time, and said we should be given special badges so that we can be distinguished when there are spoken. It's one of the most humane things. But of course, we all knew that when fighting came, the best fighters were Jamaicans.
And I have to tell you, as someone who was born in Guyana in South America and very much allies herself to the Caribbean, mm-hmm. So the stereotype in the Caribbean is that Jamaicans are descendants of Nigerians. So. The best fighters. Any more questions? We have a question here, right at the front.
Good evening, Professor. My name is Abin Bola, and you mentioned earlier that you were quite an avid reader in your youth. And so I wanted to ask, other than the sort of magazine adverts that you read, what would you say is a piece of literature that you were particularly fond of? At that time,
the difference between...
What, you talked about being an avid reader as you were growing up. What particular literature were you fond of? Were there any particular writers or genres that you read more than any others?
Even today. Okay, let me tell you what sort of literature I grew up on. I can name a few books. First of all, Charles Dickens. Charles Dickens, my father's library, small library, was full of Charles Dickens, often in the bulgarized version. Then there were some Greek classics. I remember distinctly the Medea of Euripides, which is one of my early encounters with literature in emotions in literature in the rawest sense. That's why I remember that time. Dickens, his characters just fascinated me. They were, apart from that, very curious names, you know, Uriah Heep. I mean, how can anybody think of a name like that? Uriah Heep. But I read those passages over and over again. I'm getting very fond of this Uriah Heep. Just the character, the atmosphere, the exotica, the Bible also, I read. For me, the Bible is one of the greatest works of literature. You know, most of it, literature, of course, like all scriptures, literature. You can call them revelations if you like. For me, they're just literature. You know.
And there was someone immediately behind? Yeah.
Good evening, all. My name is Omar Lui. And my own question is just, of all your, I know you've said it before, I don't like commenting on your books, but which one is really your favorite book among the books you've written?
It depends on my mood. There are some which I'll read over and over again because I couldn't get my hands on the throat of a dictator. So that sort of compensated and calmed me down. And I said, that'll happen to him. That's right. No, it depends on my mood. I have no favorite child at all. No, permanently favorite child.
I'm so glad you said that because you would have offended those people who had a particular book that they were fond of, which was different to the one you said. Is the lady right at the back?
Professor Soyinka, you're right. I miss Nigeria. A question.
Please listen for me because I'm not hearing this at all.
I miss Nigeria.
She misses Nigeria. Mm-hmm. She says you're right because she misses Nigeria.
Oh, there's one of them. Oh, okay.
Would you say that oil has been a curse or a blessing for the country?
Do you think oil has been a curse or a blessing for Nigeria?
That one. I'm sorry, without a doubt, it's been a curse. Oil is not a curse in itself. It's how it's applied, how it's misapplied. So in that sense, it's been a curse. Most especially because leadership was so careless, so short-sighted, it turned us into a mono-product economy. And that's dangerous for any society, for any greater society.
Well, your own writing is so closely intertwined with political events. Intertwined with political events in Nigeria.
Uh-huh, yes.
And we talked a little bit about some of the challenges that we're seeing today across the world. What do you see as the role of literature and of writers in fomenting dissent?
Oh, not our literature, of course, is capable of that, obviously. Thank goodness. Life would be very, very boring and taxing. But literature certainly can hone the movement towards resistance. That is why many dictators are afraid of literature, because they, you know, it holds a potential for not just change, but of serious upheaval. But then there's also what I call shotgun literature, which we detonate and move on to the next thing. And there's a kind of literature which I tend to describe as the keeping view literature. I don't know what it's like in offices these days, but when I left school, I went to work straight in, and it was, I was placed in the letters, the papers of, you know, short letters out, memos, indents, and so on. And there used to be three trains, in, out, and then keep in view. Literature for me, most literature is keep in view. It embeds certain serious messages, even subversive messages, but it's not necessary, it's not immediately obvious. And so it stays there, and later things happen in society, and that kind of literature triggers, and acts as the, just as a trigger to up the momentum of the demand, the desire, the change, because then people have something solid, have parallels to their existence, they recognize themselves. Maybe for the first time in the literature, they put aside, they identify with the problems or the characters that have been created, and that can actually encourage a movement to attain critical mass. And then, of course, there's literature which one reads simply to extend one's horizon. One must never underestimate that or say that all literature, that kind of literature, is self-indulgence, that kind of language, which is very pertinent to certain radical minds. Totalist, in the outreach for me, is reductionist. There's literature which you pick up and you read. Sometimes you go back to it. Sometimes you just regurgitate the material of that literature in your mind. And you feel better for it. And for me, that is also the work of literature.
And can I ask you about language? Because one of the things that some writers say about what's happening currently, particularly with the development of a language that's completely associated with social media, that this is destroying the elegance of language. Do you share that view?
Oh, yes. Language can just be the use of language by the real masters of language in any language. And be just like music in one's ears, which the passage continues to go. And the masters, the real conquerors of language, it doesn't matter what they write it on. It's a set of, not necessarily bravura, and you just see the building of almost like an edifice with multi-mirror tinted ceramics. And all the time you're looking and you're hearing the words, phrases, the sentences over and over again. Or as you go along, you're just flowing with the language. Oh, that kind of language can be very, very soothing. Yes.
And do you think it's being in any way destroyed by the language of social media?
What should...
Do you think that you talk about the elegance of language, mm-hmm. and listening to passages, mm-hmm. over and over again. Mm-hmm. Do you think that that's in any way being destroyed by the language of social media, the shorthand of social media?
Do you mean the current language of youth these days?
Yes. Yes.
The tweet language.
Actually, I don't think young people tweet, actually. I think they Snapchat and Facebook. And I think people like me tweet, but they don't take any notice of it.
Well, if we admit, and we must, and it is a kind of new language, there's no harm learning that language. But if that language is about to dominate the language that you and I understand the language, then we have to send them back to school. Well, we are not going back to school. That's out of the question. We've got to stick by our language. Well, I don't mind being made fun of by my children when they say, when I say, applications. This is how fast this language moves. You say applications. You know, I know that application and I try to use it. And they say, well, I said, you know, the application which you taught me last year. Yeah, no, this is okay. I said, application, you know, that's what I try to use. Oh, you mean apps? Yeah. And you really feel think you're too old for this world.
Let's take some more questions. I'm going to come over here. Right down here at the front.
Ekwale. That means good evening to the non-Yorubas in the house. My question to you, Professor Soyinka, is as a Yoruba monk myself, I want to, you know, preserve the language and pass it on to my children. What is your feelings about second generation Nigerians living in the UK? How can we preserve our heritage and our language and pass it on to our children without still being British but being Nigerian at the same time? Yoruba in particular.
Well, the first thing is to make them understand that they are missing something. How you do it, I don't know. Because to be able to do that, first of all, they have to learn to listen. I remember some years ago, I got alarmed. I was hearing noises from my son's bedroom. And it was, I thought he was under attack. I dashed to his bedroom, and there he was, in one of these video games. Are you in pain? He was actually playing with somebody in the Ukraine. And they were screaming at each other and chatting with each other at the same time. He was so absorbed in it. So that's why I say that language, this language we're talking about, is tied to us. It's tied to the latest gadget. It's tied to useful or useless, leisure or learning and stuff. So it's technology is taking over. And that is the part which aligns me. And we have to use opportunities like this to try and indoctrinate, you know, the younger. Don't lose the other language. It's an addition, even if you don't use it, at least learn how to use it, how to understand it, in case someday you need it. Even with the most advanced technology, one of these days you have to write your thesis, or else you have to write a brochure, you know, to enable, you know, dumb heads like me, which we can understand. So even to promote your technology, you've got to use what I consider is more universal language. Maybe your children will survive without this language. But for now, as long as those bookshops are there, as long as literature is being recorded, even on CDs, etc., and it's good listening. Something was on my tongue, but I'm not going to say it. Maybe it'll come up later. You mustn't lose this language. That's the main thing. I think that's all one can do. And in any case, refuse to use that language when you are talking to your children. You just say, you have to understand me, otherwise we don't understand each other.
I'll take a couple more, one here.
Yes, following the languages issue, I'm Cuban, and soon after you won your Nobel Prize, you went to Cuba, and you were working in Yoruba, and I remember that you said that how could we save the classic Yoruba?
How could we save
the classical Yoruba language?
How to save the classical Yoruba language?
Yes.
You said that in Havana.
Mm-hmm.
And I visited your country, and many of us have been visiting your countries and other part of Africa. But I really would like to ask you, what do you think would you be able to do, African people and African countries, about us in the diaspora in order to preserve what we really think is very treasured and very precious to us? Thank you.
Yeah. It's a difficult question, that it's a kind of question which is debated even for internal use on the continent. And my practical solution, and the solution which a number of us came to when we were of the African peoples, which included the diaspora, Africa in the diaspora, was that we should adopt a common language into which the works of writers in different colonial languages and even writing in indigenous languages can have their works translated so that those works are accessible to other cultural Africans as well in the diaspora. This is not to exclude the continued use of indigenous languages. And Africans in the diaspora, either in the university or in community schools, as happened, by the way, during the Black Liberation Movement, when lots of African Americans decided they were going to study at least one African language, and they chose whichever. Some chose Hausa, some chose Yoruba, some chose Kiswahili. Quite a number thought Kiswahili was the only African language which existed. Mm-hmm. We had to correct that. There's nothing wrong in being multilingual, but ultimately it's a question of will, the desire to reconnect in some way or the other. Yoruba, the pure antecedent Yoruba, some of it even abstruse for some of us, is still spoken in parts of Brazil, for instance, where the purity of the language they brought, especially the liturgical language, some of them don't even understand what it means. But they chant it, they say it, they use it, they have one or two words that they use among themselves, and so on. So outside the regular school curriculum, and African languages are now being taken more seriously as disciplines in their own right, in some colleges, especially in the States. In the Caribbean, I'm not so sure. But community colleges, extracurricular, community co-hearing mechanisms, language is one of them, to be able to speak a language which the enemy doesn't know. It's very, very good for feeling a community apart from the rest. So that's all I can add. And of course, we must make those books accessible, you know, at very cheap rate, as much as possible. It's one of the measures we decided upon in the time of Senghor, who encouraged such versions. These days, of course, I'm afraid a lot of all those ideas, I'm talking about the Renaissance period.
There's a lady up at the back who's had her hand up for a while.
Hi, I wanted to ask you about your poetry writing. I'm a poet, I was born in Africa, and I'm interested to know how often you write poetry, what is your discipline, what inspires you to write new poetry?
A question about your poetry.
Mm-hmm.
How often do you write poetry? What inspires you to write poetry? And what is your discipline when you write poetry?
I knew it was a difficult question. That's why I didn't hear it.
That's why you didn't hear it.
I didn't hear any of it at all. Among the things which I read as a child was poetry. Some of it's simple poetry for children. I was very fond of what I call lyrical poetry. I'm not talking about English poetry, I'm talking about traditional poetry also, what we call the Ijala Iwi, which is to be chanted in my hearing by the practitioners, the sort of equivalent of griot in certain other places. And I find that certain experiences just call for expression in that rather condensed, succinct, and at the same time, intrinsically expansive manner, what we call metaphors, for instance. And I grew up trying my hand at poetry, writing poetry. I'm not sure sure I wouldn't be embarrassed to see some of the things I wrote at the time. Heaven knows what others are like. But some of those lines, in fact, have stuck in my brain till today. And sometimes I have cause to remember some of the poems I read as a child. And it's exactly the same thing with the other forms of literature. Drama was in the streets, performance, and I read drama, and I also read short stories, and so I tried my hand at short stories. And then I came to concentrate more on drama, perhaps because, as I said earlier, drama was so much in the streets, so much in the environment. Traditional drama, both the what you call the masquerades, the ancestral masquerades, and then the secular masquerades also, with their body dialogue and so on and so forth. It's something that just happens to one. I think the form, the principal form in which one works, eventually chooses one rather than the other way around. That's the only answer I can give you.
I'm going to take one final question. Oh, dear. Well, no, I'm not going to take a question from this one. Here's a move for the camera. It's got to be from somebody else, external to start. There.
My name is Angelica Moore. I'm originally from the States. I've finished my master's here in African studies. And I'm very much so interested in you as an elder. What advice would you give us as Black youth? Would you recommend that we revive maybe a Pan-Africanist movement? Because in relation to what the gentleman and young lady said, it seems to be a lot of conflict in how we even identify ourselves and as a means of, I guess, progression. Because, you know, I'm going to be quite frank with you. I'm confused in which direction I should go with the education that I've received here. And with all the division that's going on, I mean, even ethnically speaking, since moving here, I hear people say, oh, I'm Jamaican. No, I'm Nigerian. It's this, that, and the third. How do we even move forward with trying to rebuild what's been broken and unify to make our world better? Mm-hmm. Thank you.
You first.
No.
Okay.
I have to tell you, this is the one occasion when I'm delighted that the question is addressed to you, Professor.
First of all, yeah. Pan-Africanism is not one of those tasks that ever get finished. It's a continuing process. And its transmission and its ability to draw, not so much to draw people into it, because people choose anyway, but to make it percolate into the relationship of different groups, ethnic groups, individuals, families, etc., in a meaningful way, takes place all the time, imperceptibly. It's not only when we have the Pan-African Congresses or Pan-Africanism is used or misused by African leaders, especially, that Pan-Africanism exists. I would like to say, for instance, that after the Pan-African Conference of which took place in Tanzania, when President Nyerere was the host, and when the gathering turned into an ego, you know, a really tawdry ego struggle fight between, shall we say, the Senghorians on the one side and the Sekuturians on the other. Yeah. Sometimes I'm tempted to say that was the death of Pan-Africanism. No, Pan-Africanism just is not dead as long as people have a consciousness of it. On many levels, take for instance, I don't know if you know the history of this particular conference I'm talking about. That was when radical movements like the dual movement, the is allowed in there. When, for instance, Walter Rodney, who was staying in Dar es Salaam, was actually told to go and stay in Dodoma during the conference because his president didn't want him there. Whereas Pan-Africanism was supposed to be outside government. So the essence of it is getting people both on the African continent and the diaspora, the trade unionists, prelates, student movements, etc. This was the essence of Pan-Africanism before it was taken over by governments who used it to hound, to persecute their perceived enemies, their dissidents, and so on and so forth. So that's why sometimes I'm tempted to say the spirit of Pan-Africanism died there. But of course, it didn't die there. And that's why from time to time you find efforts being made to structure it, to have another huge Pan-African Congress. But a near mortal blow was dealt to it during that conference. Even I was suffer from it because the government in Nigeria sent word to that I shouldn't be allowed to speak, even though I was in exile. Later on, I actually met President Yerere, spoke to some of his officials who are part of the prevention, shall we say, squad in that place. But I still got to speak anyway, in groups and so on and so forth. So it was taken away from us, from the people themselves. And as I said, a near mortal blow was dealt to it. But I don't think it's dead. I think it's very much alive in the spirit of... Talk to Rastafarians, for instance. They might not use the word Pan-Africanism, but they're very much, very strong Pan-Africanists in that movement and many other liberation movements in the diaspora are actually other expressions for Pan-African spirit. Sorry.
What should the young people do now?
Oh, I don't know what I can say. Keep up that spirit. Gather together, meet. Notting Hill Festival is part of the Pan-African spirit, for instance. That's what I mean by Pan-Africanism in so many forms. Reignite the sense of cultural living, which you have brought to outside the continent, but cultural life, the values, the positive values which you brought from over there, which your parents brought from over there. But let me give you a small instance. When I went to Jamaica for the first time, I went to teach at University of West Indies, I heard there for the first time of a certain place called Bekuta, in Westmoreland County in Jamaica. I said, Bekuta, that sounds familiar. So the next time, again, I came there, I said, well, the first thing I want to do is visit Westmoreland County and find this Bekuta. Sure enough, we drove there, and there was this small settlement of escaped slaves who had come from my hometown, and which means under the rock. Abeokuta, that's the full name. And this ancient lady whose bed constantly looked over the rocks because they chose that redoubt. First of all, because their slave owners couldn't catch them there, but also because it reminded them of the rock hills of Abeokuta. And they kept up the culture. I mean, they still were part and parcel of modern Jamaica. But you went to Westmoreland to Bekuta. And there's this old lady and those who, she was the last surviving. She went there, up there as a child. She was the last surviving member of the SKPs. And they kept up the culture and so on. Unfortunately, when I went back the last time, that village had disappeared. They suffered from floods and then some other natural disaster. Their crops were lost and their spirit was broken. And the lady was dead, and she was the real, she was one who kept up that African flexibility, not just tradition, the dances, keeping the masquerades, the costumes year after year, and that place had disappeared. I think the government of Jamaica should have ensured that a place like that was somehow integrated into the day-to-day existence of American people so they can see and touch and taste at first hand the history of where they came from. This for me is the Pan-Africanism I'm talking about, which really cannot and should not be.
We have actually run out of time, but I wanted to ask you one final question, if I may. And we've seen a sense of the mischief and your sense of fun in some of your answers tonight. Some of your answers tonight. Your home is in a forest in Nigeria. You only let cars come to a certain point, and then you have various signs along the way to try and ensure that people leave their cars behind. And I just wanted to read one of them out. And it says, and I quote, "Trespassing vehicles will be shot and eaten." I just wanted to ask you, why is it so important for you to protect that sense of peace and serenity of the forest? And what does it do for you?
I have to say, again, it's one of these quirks one doesn't really kind of explain. But from early childhood, I just found I was more at home in the orchard, which existed in our compound, just sitting in the tree, and I was very, very grumpy when I'd be fetched. Not at dinner time, but
food has been a threat.
to kind of be summoned to do some housework, you know, and I was busy communing. And then, of course, my father did some hunting, and I would follow him, not any serious hunting, but he just pottered around shooting at wild pigeon and the occasional squirrel. Edible squirrel, one of those cheeky ones who frolic around here. And I just grew up, but when I returned, and I studied in these, and I enjoyed rambling. They call it rambling. I disappear into semi-wilds. It's something very difficult to explain. So when I got back, one of the first things I wanted to do was to get myself a gun so I could do some serious hunting. And when it was time to, I was about to say when I saved enough, that's a lie, I never saved enough money after the Nobel Prize, when I could afford to build something, my first task was to look for land, which would be isolated, completely isolated. And it was isolated for a long while, for many years, until development quarter with me. Fortunately, I still had enough forest untouched. But then to come home, and I've never been comfortable in what I call fortress architecture, which has become the norm, not only in Nigeria, in other places. And my house is always wide open. I have no fence or anything. It's not just the trees and the shrub. But then to come after a long journey, and find, much as I love people, to find a family encamped literally at my doorstep. The car there and they are picnicking. And sometimes they just drive in, take pictures, you know, and I wonder that things when one just doesn't want to see a human being. I mean, that's natural. So I decided to turn cannibal. And that's when I pissed on the board. Trespassing vehicles will be shot. And I don't like them to think I'm one of these safari hunters who just shoot for even vehicles to know, I will eat them.
Professor Soyinka, thank you for a wonderful conversation.